So let us now look at an example of how machine learning can be used for real world applications. So for this particular example, we will be using gene expression data set, which contains gene expression measurements for around 7,000 genes on 72 leukemia patients. This is a binary classification problem to classify patients with ALL or AML. So first of all we will be looking at how SVM or support vector machines are implemented. So to start with, we'll import the modules for array operations and data frame for managing arrays and data frame. So next we will be importing our data. And for importing a data, we are using a read CSV function from pandas library. So as we can see, our data has around 7,130 columns. Each column corresponds to a gene measurement. And the last column of our data is the classification or the label for our classification problem. As we can see from the data sets, the values are within a huge range. So maximum value we can see is around 1971 and the minimum value is of -656. So what we can do now is to bring all of these values to within the same range. So what we can do is we will scale our data. So for scaling our data, we are using scale function from our sklearn's pre-processing module. And this will scale all the values with mean zero and a unit variance. So after scaling these data, what we will do is we will extract the target label out of it. So we can see the target labels are ALL and AML, and these all are in strings. So our computers cannot handle string data. So we need to convert them into numeric values. So to converting them into numeric values, we will use a label encoding, which is a method of converting textual or label or categorical data into our numeric data. So after fitting a label encoder to a target variable, so we will get a values which are 0 and 1. So 0 is corresponding to ALL class and 1 corresponds to AML class. So after we have got this, so let us see what our data distribution is. So we can see that we have 47 examples of class 0 and 25 examples of class 1. So we have pre-processed, once we have pre-processed the data, let's get into the model building. So for model building, so we will be using SVC, which is a support vector classifier. It is available in sklearn's SVM module. So, and also for validation purpose, we will be using cross validation. So, which is available in sklearn's model selection module. And we will also be importing few evaluation metrics, which are accuracy score, Matthews correlation coefficient, and F1 score. So once we have this, we will need to convert these evaluation metrics into the scorers. So these scorers help us during the cross validation. So we will be creating these scorers using make scorer function from sklearn's metrics module. So let us actually run our model or a support vector classifier model with the default parameters, and we will be using 5-fold cross validation, and for the scoring we are using accuracy. So let us see what the results are. So here we got around 86% accuracy, but as we see that we are using default values, but support vector classifiers support lot of have different kernel functions in it, which takes care of handling the non-linearity, and also they have each of these kernel functions have their individual parameters. So let's look at some of them. So first is a linear kernel, and linear kernel as such don't have any parameters. So let's try our support vector classifier with linear kernel. So for this also we are using a five-fold cross validation, and whatever model validation we will be using for our example, all of them will be done using five-fold cross validation. So we can see support vector SVM with linear kernel has given us of around 96% accuracy. So this is a huge jump from 86%, which was with default parameters. So now let us look at another kernel function, which is the polynomial kernel function. So polynomial kernel function has three parameters, which are a coef zeros, a gamma, and the degree. So let us see how changing these different parameters affect the results. So initially we have taken value of degree to be 2, coefficient to be 1, and value of gamma to be 0.01. And with these parameters, we were getting an accuracy of 68%. So let's change our value for coefficient. So now we are changing a value for coefficient to 3. And by changing this coefficient value, we can see that the result got better. And now we are getting 72% accuracy. And now let's try changing the value for gamma. And for this, we are using gamma's value as 0.01. So now our result again dropped from 72% to 66%. So another kernel function which is available in SVM is a radial basis function, or RBF for short. So this has only one parameter, which is gamma. As we can see, it is exponential of minus gamma times minus gamma times second norm of u minus v. So let's try this with a gamma value of 0.01. So we are getting around 65% accuracy. So now the last function we will look into for SVM is a 10 hyperbolic function. So this function is similar to our polynomial kernel. Instead, we have only two parameters, which is coefficient and gamma. So let's see how these values are affecting. So we can see with our 10H, with our sigmoid function, sigmoid kernel, we are getting an accuracy of around 80%. Since we see that changing all of these values, we are getting a different accuracy, and these accuracies are changing a lot. So we need to actually tune these hyperparameters. And for tuning this, we are using greed search method. And also we will be using a train test split, where our entire data will be divided into two parts. One will be used for training our model, and the test part will be used for validating those results, validating the trained model. So for dividing our data into train and test, we are using train test split function from sklearn's model selection library. And for this purpose, and for our purpose, we are using a test size of test size value to be 0.02, which means that 20% of our data, of our complete data, will be used as a test data. For grid search, we are using grid search CV from sklearn's model selection. And for grid search, we need to provide the values for each of these parameters, and it will try to find the best combination out of it. So the parameter values pass as a dictionary, and here we are using the name for this dictionary as param grids. So we can see that for coef zero, we have passed, we are giving a range of 1 to 10. Then for gamma, we are having a values of 0.01, 0.001, 0.01, 0.1, 1, 10, and 100. Then degree, we are having at 1, 2, and 3. And kernel functions, we are using as linear, polynomial, and RBF, and sigmoid. So these this parameter grid and a base classifier, which is the SVC for our case, will be passed on to this grid search CV function. And again, for our validation, we will be using fivefold cross validation. The scoring will be done based on MCC, Matthews correlation coefficient. So let's fit this. Let's try to find out what the best parameters are. So finding the so this tuning our model may take some time, because we can see there are 432 different combinations of our parameters, and for each parameter combination we are doing a fivefold cross validation. So our model will be building total 2160 models. So this may take some time. So our grid search CV is complete, and it has actually found the best parameter. So let's see what those parameters are. So it has found that the best result was with linear kernel. So we know that linear kernel doesn't have any parameter, but our grid search has written the values for all the parameters. But when we will be fitting these values, these parameter values will not be considered while building the model if we pass the kernel as linear. So the sklearn's support vector classifier module will take care of it. So using these best parameter values, let's build our classifier, and this will be the best estimator which we can find. So using this, now let's find the cross validation score, or fivefold cross validation score for this best estimator. So you can see that with this we have got around 96% accuracy. Then we are getting around 91% of MCC Matthews correlation coefficient value, and we are getting around 93% of F1 score. Till now we have seen how a support vector machine can be used for doing the classification. So let us now see how a random forest can be used. So for random forest also, we will be first importing the NumPy and pandas module to handle arrays and data frames. Then again, we will be importing the data using pandas read CSV function. Then since it's the same data that we are using, we will again be scaling our data using the scale function from sklearn's pre-processing. And once it is done, then we will be extracting our Y values or target labels. Again, we will be label encoding these values. It's the same data, so distribution will be same. And since random forest classifier is an ensemble, it's an ensemble model, so it is available in sklearn's ensemble module. So we will be importing sklearn's random forest classifier and other functions for our performance evaluation and model validation. So we'll again be creating our scorers for accuracy, MCC, and F1 score. Before we see how this works, let's see what the most frequently used parameters for random forest. So first is N estimator. So N estimator means how many number of trees we want to make in for our forest. Then next parameter is max feature. So max feature means what is the maximum number of features we will be considering for finding the best split for each tree. Then the next parameter is max depth. So max depth means what will be the max depth for each tree in the forest. And the last parameter we will be using is criteria. So criteria is
basically a function to measure quality of a split. So a random forest supports two methods. So one is Genie, which when used will calculate, will find the split based on Genie impurity. And the another method is entropy. And if entropy is used, information gain will be used for finding the best split. So let us see how the default model of random forest classifier performs. So we can see with default parameters, we have got an accuracy of 95.8%. So let's try to change some change the values of these parameters and see how this impact our accuracy. So we can see if we have selected n estimators to be 100, max features to be 1000, max depth to be 20, and we are using Genie as a criteria. So we can see we are getting around same accuracy, which is 95.8%. But if we change our number of features from 1000 to 500, we are getting around 98.5% accuracy. So we can see that we are still getting different accuracies for different parameters. That means we again need to tune our model. And for tuning, we are using grid search. And for tuning a parameter, we will again be using test and train split with test size of 20% of a total data. So this will be done using train test split function from test train split function from sklearn's model selection module. So now for, as we have seen for SVM, that grid search requires dictionary of parameters and their range. So for here, for each of the parameters, the ranges were defined as follows. So for n estimators, the range is the values we will be trying out are 50, 100, 200, 300, and 500. The max, for the max feature, we are using values of 0.01, 0.1, 0.2, 0.5, 0.08. And along with this, we are using an inbuilt value, which is auto. And auto in this case, that the max number of features will be equal to square root of number of total number of features within a data. And since we are using the float values, float value will correspond to the percentage. So for example, 0.01 will correspond to 1% of our total features, 0.1 will correspond to 10%, and similarly 0.8% means max features will be 80% of our total features. And similarly for max depth, values we will be trying out are 10, 20, 50, and 100. And along with this, we are again using a parameter which is none. So none in this case means that we will not impose any limit for our tree depth, and our tree is allowed to grow as much as possible. And for our criteria, we will be trying out both Genie and entropy. So let's run this grid search CV. Now grid search is done now. So let us see what are the best parameters grid search has found for us. So we can see for the best parameters, we have got our criteria as Genie, max depth as none. And the max feature is 0.1. That means 10% of our total features were used for finding the best split, and number of trees used are 500. So let us using these parameters, let us now build our best estimator. And let's validate this best estimator using fivefold cross validation for accuracy, MCC, and FN score. So our model has been run, and the performance measures we got are, we have with our best estimator, we have got a 95.8% accuracy, 0.94 as our MCC value, and 0.909 as our F1 score. So as we have seen that trend, how random forest and support vector machines can be used for classification.
But since we have very high dimensional data, we have around more than 7,000 features. So in such high dimensional data, it is often possible that some of our features are not important, or even some of the features may include some noise to our model, which can hamper the overall classification. So it is best to do a feature selection, which means that we need to find the smallest subset of our feature, which can give us the best accuracy. So do that. So let's see how this can be done using random forest. So for doing this using random forest, we will first need to build a model, a random forest model, using the best parameters which we get. So once we have built our best model, then using that we can find the feature importance of each feature. So this feature importance is a score which is allocated to each feature, which corresponds to how important that feature is for overall classification. So once we have got our feature importance, so the next step is to sort our features according to our feature importance. So we can get we can get a list of features from highest importance to lowest importance. Since we need to select a subset of features, for our purpose we will be trying out different sizes of this subset. So for example, we will try out a subset with only 10 features in it, then subset with 25 features, and so on. We will also try a subset with 6,000, with 5,000 and 6,000 features in them. We will be finding out the best subset using our accuracy. So let's iterate it on this subset list and try to find out one by one which subset of features give us the best accuracy. And this subset means that if you're selecting 10, a subset of 10, then the top 10 features will be selected from the based on feature score. And similarly for 6,000, top 6,000 features will be selected based on this feature score. So we have ran through all of our subset sizes, and let's try to visualize the results. For visualization, we will be using Matplotlib. And so we can see from here that different feature sizes have given us different accuracy values. So we can see that the maximum value we are getting is around 98.5. And this value is coming up for various feature sizes. So we can see, so out of all of these, we will go with the smallest feature size, and we will select the small feature size, small subset, because this small number of genes can actually help us give the biomarkers which are most important for the classification. So we have around like 60%, 65% of examples belonging to class 0, and rest 35% of examples belong to class 1. So the data is slightly imbalanced, and we are using k-fold for our model validation. So instead of using k-fold, a better option would be stratified k-fold cross validation. The folds are made by preserving the percentage of samples from each class. Stratified k-fold is available in sklearn's model selection, and we will be using that. So for finding out the final stratified k-fold cross validation, so we will be using our final best parameters, and we will be using only the top 25 features which we got from the previous feature selection. So let's see how this smaller subset with stratified k-fold cross validation performs. So we can see, as our imbalance was comparatively low, so we can see that doing a stratified cross validation has not given a much of boost in our performance, and we are still getting around 98.5% accuracy.